Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Have you announced the proceeding?
Yes.
Okay. So, you call someone for recitation?
Recitation hogi dobara. Recitation hogi, introduction hogi.
So I am at your disposal to answer any questions which you may address to me. Just feel free at home.
Human society is so corrupt here with us. How can we more effectively get God's message across?
Can you once again?
No, I understand, yes, but for the sake of recording, would you please repeat your
human
question?
Human society seems to be so corrupt.
Yes.
How can we, as individuals, get God's message across more effectively?
And the point is that every disease has to be first analyzed and diagnosed. Why are we corrupt as human beings and tend to be corrupt? After repeated messages come to reform us, every time we fall back to the same old trend of pursuing the worldly pleasures, which in itself is not a bad thing. To pursue pleasure is good. But when you are given up to pursuit of pleasure, then right and wrong are all forgotten. Then you must have it, like addiction. So it is that part of pleasure which is condemned by God. Otherwise, everything present is good for his servants. But when it is at the cost of someone else, then pleasure causing pain to others is what is rejected. But why are we so corrupt? That has to be analyzed. And unless we reach the root causes and begin the cure from there, just the superficial treatment would not mean anything. Yesterday I discussed this matter with some would-be member of parliament who had also come to attend my question and answer session. And he was deeply concerned about what was happening in Britain. The moral degradation, the rise of crime, and lack of sensibility to others, players in sufferings. And I told him that you should have learnt your message from the most beastly killing of the innocent children in Scotland. Just to talk of superficial changes in the law and go for legislative reforms or give to strengthen the hands of the police is not at all a relevant answer to that problem. That problem lies elsewhere and deeper in your society. It has a relationship with the overall rising crime of child abuse. And generation after generation things have been happening where people grow up with a sense of suffering and inferiority complex at the hands of their elders, at the hands of the society around. So they nurture these passions of revenge quietly until they burst into a flare of what you saw. He was not a madman, because madmen don't show cruelty to children. He was not a sane man either. He was on the borderline of madness and sanity, and he was in fact in a distorted image of the society, which was going. Now, you do not reform your television programs, you do not put restrictions on what is to be shown or published, and how people's private lives are probed and why should they be probed by the media and so on. When the royalty itself is not safe, not because the royalty has a special right, but it becomes a focus of attention of all the people. What happens there, what is tolerated there, is tolerated at every other level, even more so. So there are many things which are wrong and which are getting more and more twisted with the passage of time. No legal reformation is the answer. You strengthen the hands of the police, and the police itself is a part of the whole society. And unfortunately, the standard of police is not at all the same as it was years ago when I was here. I was here as a student. So things have to be analyzed cool-mindedly, not politically, but wisely, at a forum of people from all walks of life and their representatives participating in a meaningful search for truth and search for the right measures. Morality is what is missing, unfortunately. Morality, not just Christian, but any morality is morality. Religious morality is one unsplittable thing, and it's universal. So when I speak of morality, I mean, do not mean Islamic morality or Christian morality or Jewish morality. To me, morality has to be universal or it is not morality. Whatever name you may give it, it is not right until it has to be universal. So with a determination to resolve your problems armed with universal concept of morality, where racism does not play a part, where differences of areas, north and south and east and west, are not permitted to be counted as factors. Just a human responsibility should be discharged at human level. Then you will see there have to be effected many reforms in your media, in your treatment of many daily problems. The concept of freedom has to be rectified once again. It has to be thoroughly examined. What do you mean by freedom? Freedom to what extent? How far? You know, if my hand is free and my hand is not free, where his nose begins, you know, of course. And similarly, we have a relativity in our relationship. Freedom in which areas? Now, again, one very important factor which has to be brought to the notice of the British as a whole is that they are dividing a line between responsibility to man-made legislation and responsibility to divine legislation. And this treatment is so prejudicial in favor of man-made that when children, particularly young girls, teenage girls, grow up in the school and the teachers feel that their parents are pressurizing them or advising them very strongly to behave morally. According to the expectations of their religious teachings. Now, they are always told you are free. What right have they got? If your parents interfere overmuch, then you better go to the social department and they will take care of you. And this happens. Many a home is absolutely shattered. And the future of these girls is absolutely destroyed. The sense of irresponsibility which comes with it, this apparent shelter, they are rendered shelterless. And when the same teenagers reach the age of maturity, then do you know the message of the law and the school and colleges? Previously we ignored your faults, but man-made laws will be fully supported by law. And if you violate the laws, now you will be punished. Same thing. When they mature, they are told not to take care at all, not to take care in the least of what God expects them of moral behavior. But what society and the state expects them of the man-made law, which are of course defective everywhere. And this is why they keep on changing and yet they do not serve full purpose. They must be respected. So when you divide a line between moral values and the state values, then ultimately the state values do suffer. This is a simple message which simply, I don't know how they afford to miss. Because if the moral standard is not fully supported and maintained, the responsibility to human legislation cannot be created. So a religiousless society, an immoral society, will not be responsible or will not feel responsible to the man-made laws. As long as they can steal and do things in hiding, they will continue to do. This sense of responsibility only comes from moral teaching, religious moral teaching. This is what happened to communism. It is wrong to say that communism failed as a system. It failed because of lack of morality. The very system was in the hands of those who were immoral, who had no moral values. So why should they not turn the system to their own personal advantages? That is what happened in Russia. That is what brought the downfall of all communist regimes everywhere. So this is a message which had to be learned, and you should go deeper into the root causes. And then let's pray and join hands in everything good which we may bring about in the society together. Right? Yes? Yes?
Dennis Wallace, and I'm a practicing Catholic.
Yes.
When we talk about morals, how about the morals of God? When we have so much wealth in part of the world, and so much degradation and poverty in other parts of the world and suffering, how can we justify that that's God's will?
We don't. We can't. When there is such cruelty perpetrated by man against man, when you permit others to suffer, who are again God's creatures like you are, and you do not share their misery, and you have no concern for others' way of life, their happiness, their suffering, then you can't call yourself a true Catholic or a true believer in any religion. Because one fundamental message which is delivered by all religions is that those who love God, they love His creation as well. Those who serve God, they must serve also His creation. There is no dividing line between your relationship with God and your relationship with human beings. This is what I have understood from the study of various religions. That is why at the start I said that I do not invite you to just the Islamic morals, because that requires many a barrier to be removed first, psychological and doctrinal barriers. But when I invite you to morals which are universally accepted as morals, that's the easiest formula to work for, to work with at a universal level. So the point you have raised only indicates that your Christianity is deficient in as much as you permit this suffering to continue without feeling for it. And if you go deeper, then you'll realize that you are in fact creating and abetting that suffering in so many ways, because your politics is not Christian. That is the main problem. Your economy is not Christian. Your social behavior is not Christian. And the same is true of Muslim countries. So where is religion? It's only in the name. When religion actually becomes a reality, then the world must change into a heaven on earth. If it does not, then it is nothing wrong with the religion, but it's wrong with the people who claim to be religious. Right? Thank you. Abed, could you bring me a hot cup of hot water, please? No tea, nothing, just hot water. Yes?
What is Islam's view on corporal punishment, in particular the death penalty, bearing in mind that other Muslim sects decreed that the likes of Salman Rushdie should die?
Well, there are two different questions altogether. Yeah. Don't mix them. I'll come to them if you want, one after the other. The corporal punishment, or whatever punishment there is, has a philosophy behind. Otherwise, to make others suffer is no goodness in itself. If punishment is related to the prevention of crime, then it's excellent. And it should not be more than necessary for the prevention of crime. This is the fundamental principle which is followed by religions as a whole. In Islam, it's very clearly shown that if somebody is killed by someone, those who suffer most are his kith and kin. And the state is an impartial observer, or an observer which does not share the suffering and misery as such. So why should state forgive a crime committed against a society or a family, which causes traumas to not only one but sometimes so many of them, with which they have to live for their lives? Then corporal punishment is not just one single issue. It is a complex issue, a many-sided issue. Murders are murders, but they belong to different categories, different styles. Some murders are the result of an emotional upheaval which a man cannot suppress. Some are calculated murders. Some murders are, just like mercy killing. And some are heinous, absolutely. More brutal than you find in the killing of beasts of other animals in the animal kingdom. So why should you treat all these crimes with one yardstick? They're different crimes, different situations. So according to Islam, capital punishment is not essential, but it cannot be ruled out either. In places it will be required, there you must give capital punishment, or crime will not be prevented. In cases where forgiveness is better and it reforms the criminal, then according to the Quran, forgiveness must always be preferred, provided it reforms the criminal, not if it strengthens the hands and intentions of the criminal. So it's a complex issue. It has to be decided on merit in every case separately. The right to forgive the corporal punishment in Islam belongs to the kith and kin of the deceased. Please?
I was just going to ask you.
That's right. Yes.
Because it's very important.
Yes, it is indeed. Anything else, please?
Earlier this year, a dissident from Saudi Arabia was cast out of this country due to views that he had on his own country. Now, the government removed him because they had a deal with Saudi, with money.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what are your views on governments around the world that treat money more than people?
You see, have you not realized that in every modern government, the national interests are always given preference over all other considerations? And if they come to clash with their moral values, with your values of, with regards to mercy, kindness, etc., the other values are ignored and rejected at the cost of the national interests, which are material. So we are living in a materialistic society. And it becomes very difficult even for a very highly civilized government to ignore the material dictates. So in this, they were caught in a dilemma. The British government has built an image of the British people and the British trends, that we care for human values and we support the templed people The human beings who suffered at the hands of other human beings, the human beings who had suffered at the hands of the government and so on. This is the moral image we have created. Like America had created the image of being champion of nations which are trampled by dictatorship, which are completely subjugated to the will of some despots and so on. So these are good images, but when the same images come to clash with some other realities where personal relationship, personal gains, personal interests are at clash with such images, these images are always demolished, destroyed by those who possess these images, who have built, done so much to build that image in the world. Look at the American record, for instance. What happened in the South American states, those despots who could not stay in power without American support, they were kept alive. Those despots who were against the interests of America, troubles were created in their country despite the fact that their despotism also had some major popularity in their own countries. But in other countries, the yardstick becomes different. Same is the case of the European policy as such. They want to help the downtrodden, the ill-treated, etc., genuinely, fairly, but not at the cost of their national interest. That is why I spoke of universal morality, not morality which is only conditional, is only related to smaller regional interests. When morality is divided into regional morality, then it is no morality. It doesn't solve any problem, it doesn't serve any purpose. So in the case you have referred to, I must pay tribute to the British government of doing it wisely, not brutally, like many other governments could have done. I'm quite sure they must have negotiated with the Saudians and telling them their limitations and compulsions and informing them that they can't hand him over directly to them. They will send him to some other place and get rid of the responsibility. So they must have diplomatically worked hard to find a country, to convince the government of that country to take this, hot brick away from them until it cools down. And that is what they did. So they, in fact, avoided the immediate crisis by doing so. At the same time, they permitted that individual to use the British law against government and feel free to do whatever he likes by going to the courts and appealing against the British decision in the British courts. This is quite fair, but as I have told you, they had some difficulty, of course, in keeping both the images correct. One was the national image of economy, the government's attitude to the British economy. And the other was the image they had made of being champions of downtrodden people and so on and so forth. Anything else, please? Yes?
Good evening, Your Holiness. My name is Nicole, and my question is, in the introduction we heard that certain prophecies prophesied by Jesus Christ were fulfilled in the second Messiah. Can you tell me what those prophecies were, please?
Yes, certain prophecies of Jesus Christ were fulfilled in relation to his second advent. Is that right? Who introduced this subject?
Bilal.
Bilal? Why didn't you illustrate yourself?
I did very briefly, I only have a short time to do so.
What prophecies did you have in mind, for instance?
I mentioned the eclipse of the sun and the moon.
What?
I mentioned the eclipse, the...
That's right, I understand. What else?
And the Holy Prophet's prophecy, the same thing, the eclipses.
Yes. You know, this is a very debatable issue as to how the prophecies should be read. That's why I inquired from him what prophecies he had in mind. I had some different prophecies in mind. But because the prophecies are always debated concerning their message and interpretation, so it's a difficult subject to enter, and on the basis of just this, it's not generally possible to make a clear-cut decision. But I had in mind a different prophecy, which is mentioned in the Holy Quran very clearly, along with the prophecy he mentioned as well. That is to say that according to the Holy Quran, Jesus Christ prophesied that after him there will be a prophet whose name would be Ahmad. And in the same surah or elsewhere, it is also mentioned that Moses also, in the same surah, it is mentioned that Moses also had made a prophecy that Muhammad will appear in the, to be the beginner of a new faith, new religion, new era. So they are done together. Prophecy of Muhammad is related to Moses. Prophecy of Ahmad is related to Jesus Christ. Now we Ahmadis interpret this that as Muhammad's prophecy obviously relates to Prophet Muhammad, his first advent. And the Ahmad's prophecy should relate to the person who would appear in the latter days like Messiah appeared in the Ummah of Moses. So what he was to Moses, so Ahmad would be to Muhammad. This is our understanding of this prophecy. And I believe it's quite logical and understandable. But it's not something which can be enforced upon others as a strong logic. But if anybody reads this with an unprejudiced, unbiased attitude, he can see the wisdom and the balance of this. The Holy Quran says Moses prophesied Muhammad and Jesus prophesied Ahmad. Now relate this to the prophecy of the Holy Prophet himself that in his Ummah, also there will be a Messiah. Like Moses prophesied the coming of Messiah and other prophets after him did. So Hazrat Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the founder of Islam, also prophesied the coming of a Messiah. Now this could be the same. Now the issue is, what is the proof of that there was Muhammad name mentioned in the Bible? The proof lies in the fact that in the older translations of Bible, the prophecy of someone coming to bring about a new faith, new religion, new era, is contained, and it is the word is translated as Muhammadin. Who would come? He will be Muhammadin. Now when the Muslims refer to this with relation to the Quranic reference, the Christians began to change, and also the Jewish people, they must have done it together, to change the translation from Muhammadin to the praiseworthy people. Now the argument they presented in favor of this change was that Muhammadin is a plural and Muhammad name is a singular. So a plural name can be translated into the meanings, translated in a manner that the meanings are translated, not, it should not be kept verbatim as such and transferred from one language to the other. This was their argument. But they do not tell you that in Hebrew, all names which are mentioned or uttered with respect are mentioned in plural. So Muhammadim is definitely a personal name of someone, but why it was pluralized was out of respect, because it is the custom of the language. Like in every language, in references, other ordinary references, we turn a singular into a plural. Instead of saying thou, you say aap, or in English, you. In Urdu, instead of saying you, tu is you, is thou, we say aap, which is a plural. So plurality in many contexts has a sense of respect. And in some languages, even the proper nouns are pluralized just out of respect. So that was no argument. They knew the laws of the language, yet they permitted this word to remain exactly the same instead of translating it. So the earlier scholars couldn't have missed the point. They were expecting somebody of this name. But when he did appear, then they began to change it. So it became controversial afterwards. Now, in case of Ahmad, also, we have the word Ahmad found in the New Testament, discovered from a monastery in Syria. The original words, which are now accepted by all scholars, were Ahmad. Now the word Ahmad can be translated as well as it can be kept as a proper noun. And it is closest to Ahmad. So again, a debate begins. But it should be strange to everybody that the Holy Quran mentions two names, and names very close, very similar to those, are actually found in the Old Testament and New Testament. So there has to be something in it. So that is one prophecy which I want to point out. And the one he already has mentioned perhaps briefly, but if it is to be elaborated, I will only say this much, that the coming of Christ, the second advent I mean, was related to some heavenly events. When the moon will be darkened and the sun will cease to emit light. The same expression is used in the Holy Quran, that فَإِذَا بَرِقَ الْبَصَرُ وَخَسَفَ الْقَمَرُ وَجُمِعَ الشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرُ, that when the sight will be dazzled by what? By seeing the moon darkened and the sun joining moon in this. What is the meaning of joining moon in this? Why did it say sun will also be darkened? This is explained by a hadith of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in which he said that the Mahdi, our Mahdi, when he appears, two heavenly signs will be shown in his favor, which have never been shown before in favor of any other claimant. And the words of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam are, إِنَّ لَمَهْدِينَا آيَتَيْنِ لَمْ تُكُونَ مُنْذُ خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ أَوَّلُهَا أَنْ يَنْكَسِفَ الْقَمَرُ فِي أَوَّلِ لَيْلَةٍ مِنْ رَمَضَانَ وَتَنْكَسِفُ الشَّمْسُ فِي النِّصْفِ مِنْهُ وَلَمْ تُكُونَ مُنْذُ خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. He said, for our Mahdi, you know, the title of Mahdi is perhaps quite familiar nowadays. Imam Mahdi you have heard, and at least you must have heard of the bloody Mahdi who appeared in Sudan. So that means Prophet Muhammad ﷺ predicted many a Mahdi to appear. How will you recognize the Mahdi who is prophesied by Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah as belonging to him? This was the question raised by him. He said, for our Mahdi, there will be two signs which cannot be tempered with at all by human beings. The heavenly signs, completely out of human control, out of human reach. Avvaloha, the first of them is that the moon will be eclipsed. and on the first night. And the second is that the sun will be eclipsed on the middle, in the middle of the days. These things, both these signs will appear in one single month, and the name of that month will be Ramadan. And this as a sign has never appeared before. Now, so many conditions are put together, that is why the word Jumu'ah, they will be brought together, is spoken of, is used instead of saying sun will also darken. They will not darken separately at different times. They will be brought together as a sign, packed in a small short space of 1 month. And the name of that month is also mentioned as Ramadan. So the question is, did this sign appear in favor of Masih Maud, whom we call the promised Messiah, or not? No, it's a matter of history. You can go to any observatory, write to them to send you the records of the period which I'm going to tell. Exactly the same thing happened, which had been predicted from that time 1300 years before. Hazrat Masih Maud al-Islam, the founder of the Ahmadiyya community, officially declared the Jamaat on 23rd of March, only 2 days ago in this year, but 23rd of March of 1889. And he claimed to be the Mahdi, the Messiah, all that was predicted about the future reformer. And there was no sign of any sun or moon's eclipse, and for them to be eclipsed together in 1 month, this was completely out of reach for any man. The observatories of that period also never mentioned such a thing. Because I have discussed this matter with knowledgeable people, highly knowledgeable people, they say such a prediction is, even today, is not possible, because the moon's phases are so variable that it's not possible for us to definitely determine that these things will happen in 1 month and also will be seen from one single horizon. That's another problem which is related to this. You know, sun can be eclipsed and moon can be eclipsed together in 1 month, but moon can be seen eclipsed from one area and the sun from the other. Both cannot be seen together from one single horizon. This is a single vantage point appearing in the same horizon. So these were all the problems involved. And every non-Ahmadi Muslim, not every, but many of course, started demanding from him, all right, if you are true Mahdi or true Messiah, show us the sign. How can you have the moon eclipsed and the sun eclipsed exactly according to the description of the prophecy? In 1894, this appeared. Exactly as it had been predicted, on the 13th of Ramadan that year, the moon was eclipsed. And on the 28th of that Ramadan, the sun was eclipsed as well. Now the only question which remains to be discussed is, how can these two dates be called the first and the middle? We believe, and which is scientific, and there is no other possibility left to us but to believe, that by the first, he meant the first of the eclipse nights. By the middle day, he meant the middle of the eclipse days of the sun. And they are fixed by God and they cannot be changed. The moon always gets eclipsed either on the 13th or 14th or 15th. These are the three fixed days, because they relate to the relationship between the movement of moon, earth and the sun. Similarly, sun can never be eclipsed beyond the three dates of 27th, 28th, 29th. And 28th is the middle. 13th is the first of the moon's eclipse. So the founder of the Ahmadiyya community not only pointed out to this, but also mentioned that your own scholars earlier had been interpreting it like this. They said the moon will be eclipsed on the 13th. Where did they read that it would be eclipsed on the 13th? While it was said on the 1st. So it had to be the first of the moon, of the nights of eclipse of moon, and the middle day of the days of the eclipse of the sun. By way of further argument, he pointed out that the moon of the first night is highly questionable, in the sense whether it appeared or did not. A very thin slice it is, and even the slightest shadows cast by some dust hanging in the horizon or clouds, etc., makes it disappear altogether. And the life is so short, the lifespan of the first moon, that it lasts, say, from 10 to 15 or half an hour, no more. So if a cloud covers it or dust particles obscure it, it will not be seen anyway. Now, on top of that, if it is eclipsed, how can you see it? Eclipse can only be noticed if the remaining part of the moon is visible and only a small part becomes invisible. So the eclipse the moon of the crescent, I mean, eclipse the crescent and it will disappear. And the time-old debate will continue once again. The mullahs, the religious clergy would say it was not, it did not eclipse, it did not appear. What do you mean by eclipse? It never appeared. And poor Imam Mahdi, he would say, no, it appeared, but we couldn't see it because it was eclipsed. So it is stupid to interpret things in a manner which are contrary to the nature created by God and contrary to the human experience. Impossible. It can't happen like that. But the third and the clinching argument is this, that Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah, the founder of Islam, is known and universally accepted by all Muslims to have the best command of Arabic after the Holy Quran. His Arabic, the quality of his Arabic is beyond a shadow of doubt, most excellent. Every Arab knows that the moon of the first three nights is referred to as crescent, hilal, never as qamar. When the moon, people speak of the moon of the first three nights, they always refer to it as al-hilal. And in English, it is referred to as crescent. The prophetic words used by the Holy Prophet of Islam were al-qamaru, yankasif al-qamaru, not al-hilalu. So did he not know Arabic? Did he not know that Arabs do not refer to the moon of the first three nights as hilal? And instead of that, if he knew from God that this would be the period when the moon would be eclipsed, he should simply have told us that it would be a crescent which will be eclipsed. He didn't. Qamar normally applies to the fuller moons of later periods. So looking at it from all angles, it leaves us no room to escape from the powerful message delivered by this prophecy, and its roots are in Jesus Christ. He prophesied first. No other prophet ever before spoke of somebody appearing in his similarity or his reappearance and pointing out that this sign will appear on the heaven. So it had to be fulfilled by his likeness, the one who would appear in his name and in his character. And this is exactly what happened. Any other questions, please?
Your Holiness, my name's George. It was mentioned on the television news last week.
Oh, yeah.
It was on the television news last week that scientists seem to agree that all alcoholic drinks are beneficial in some degree. In view of that, can you still stick by the strict Muslim ban on alcohol? And
it's not a question of scientists alone. It's a question of scientists, and it's a question of moralists, and it's a question of criminologists. their opinion put together should be considered. As far as the benefits of spirit are concerned, this is one object which is mentioned in the Holy Quran with a reference also to its benefits. While forbidden, it says it has its benefits, of course, but its harms outweigh the benefits. And the harms are briefly mentioned in principle, which speak of its power, its capability to dazzle human intellect, to befog human intellect, to capture human intellect to a degree where he is no longer in command of his actions. Now, if you read criminologists' appraisal of what is happening in the Western society in particular, you will see that the one single culprit which is attributed to be responsible most largely for the crime in our society is alcohol. And alcohol addiction is much wider than the drug addiction. And not only the crimes, but the suffering which results from alcoholism every Christmas at least, by way of killing of innocent lives and badly mauled people, etc., during driving by the alcoholics, is not a piece of information at all. Everybody knows this. Moreover, once I read a report in some British magazine which spoke of the crimes committed against women in a society which is unfortunately less advantageous economically, a lower rung of the society, of labors, etc. That report was very clear on this, that most of the crimes committed against poor women in the lowly place society are done under the influence of alcohol. And most of the deprived children must blame alcoholism of their parents or their father, because the earning which they have is not sufficient to be able to maintain a decent standard for the whole family, plus provide for their special weakness for alcohol. So they go to the pubs and return drowning their fears, drowning their sorrows, apparently at advantage, but also drowning all their sense of moral values and abusing their own wives, smashing their heads against walls, being cruel to the children, destroying the peace of home. So if you study the whole case without any prejudice, just neutrally, you will come to, I believe you will come to the same conclusion as I have myself come, that if you remove alcoholism from British society, drinking from British society, it will turn into a much better and attractive place to live, and with very little of crookedness and crime left in this. The second thing which I want to point out is that evil addictions can also be determined by the children they give birth to. You see, if you are a milk drinker, for instance, teetotaler, such habits do not create other habits which are worse than these. The simple habits, you can live for centuries with these without their giving birth to worse habits. But addiction always creates worse forms of addiction. And drug addiction is a child of alcoholism, in fact. When you can no longer be kicked to the degree that you want, when you no longer can be excited to a state which used to excite you but no more, when you want to go beyond, then of course you are in search of something like drugs of different forms and types. And this drug addiction according to my study, is definitely born out of the alcoholic addiction prior to it. Again, this drug addiction or overmuch alcoholism also is related to promotion of crime. Because when you are addicted to a player, whether it's a good player or bad player, irrelevant. When you're addicted to any player and you do not have economic means to have access to that player, then crime is willy-nilly born. Because addiction is something which demands things most terribly. A man who is addicted loses command of his own faculties and sense of justice and fair play, and he must have what he wants to have at that time. So that is the reason why these things are interrelated and they go on increasing and resulting and proliferating in other smaller or bigger evils. So I'm quite satisfied with the Islamic teaching that alcoholism is forbidden.